Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Frances Tate with the Frances B. Tate Ministries with Focus on Discipleship. Today we are celebrating the Holy Week services, commemorating Jesus' last hour here on earth. So we're going to begin our service by reading and you're hearing the scripture from St. John, the 10th chapter, beginning at the 11th verse through 18. And this is the way it reads. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. Good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. But he that is an hireling and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, see the wolf coming and leaveth the sheep and fleeth. And the wolf catcheth them and scattereth the sheep. Verse 13, Jesus said, the hireling fleeth because he is an hireling and careth not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd and know my sheep and am known of mine. As the Father knoweth me, even so know I the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. And the other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice. And there shall be one fold and one shepherd. Therefore doth any father, doth my father love me, and I might take it again, excuse me. Therefore doth my father love me, because I lay down my life, that I might take it again. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father. This afternoon, we're going to talk with you regarding this Good Shepherd. This is a time that we are celebrating, commemorating the Holy Week services. And along with the area ministers of Valdez Association, we're here to share with you words about the Good Shepherd. And we look at that 14th verse in that St. John, the 10th chapter. And this is the way it reads. I am, Jesus said that of himself, I am the good shepherd and know my sheep and am known of mine. 2,000 years ago, according to our calendar, Jesus was crucified on this day we call Good Friday at noon, 12 o'clock, and hung there on the cross until 3, from 6 to 9, Jesus hung there. Today, we are commemorating that day as we gather around the world at this hour. Again, Jesus said, according to St. John 10th, chapter verse 14, Jesus said, I am the good shepherd and am known of my own. This afternoon, we want to speak to you regarding the good shepherd in the form of a question, maybe even a sub-theme. What does the good shepherd look like? Or what are the characteristics of the good shepherd? Jesus, speaking of himself, developed this analogy as being the good shepherd in contrast of the Pharisees, who were false shepherds, who was spiritually blind. As the true shepherd, Jesus came to seek and to heal. His sheep hear and respond to his voice, but a stranger will not. And we're going to share with you maybe a characteristic of Jesus as the good shepherd. Let's look at it as the protector. When Jesus said, all who ever came before me are thieves and robbers, he referred to those leaders of the nation who cared not, absolutely nothing, nothing for the spiritual good of the people, but only for himself. Jesus, the shepherd, provides security. Jesus provides protection for his flock from enemies. And Jesus said, whoever enters through me will be saved or be kept safe. He also provides, Jesus does, for their daily needs. Jesus said, the sheep come in and go out and find pasture. But listen, the thief is like a false shepherd, cares only about feeding himself, not building up the flock. He steals sheep in order to kill them, thus destroying part of the flock and scattering them. But Christ, the good shepherd, has come to benefit the sheep. Jesus gives his life, the good shepherd, which is not constricted by overflowing. The thief takes life. Christ gives it. He gives it to the fullest. And Jesus developed a shepherd sheep figure also. Listen, when evening settled over the land of Palestine, danger lurked. I found that in Bible times, lions, wolves, jackals, panthers, leopards, bears, and hyenas were common in the countryside. And the life of a shepherd would be very, very dangerous, as illustrated by David. And you know David, being a shepherd boy, fights which with at least one lion and a bear. And he took care of his father's sheep. Being a good shepherd, can be dangerous. Jacob also experienced the labor and toil of being a faithful shepherd. Jesus said again, I am the good shepherd. In the Old Testament, God is called the shepherd of his people. Jesus is this to his people, and he came to give life for whose benefit? For his sheep's benefit. He is also called the great shepherd, the chief shepherd. And listen, in contrast with the gospel, with the good shepherd, Jesus owns. Do you hear me? Jesus owns. Jesus cares. Jesus feeds. Jesus protects. And Jesus dies. Key word. Jesus dies for his sheep. The one who worked for wages, the hired hand, does not care. Does not have the same commitment. He is only interested in making money and in self-preservation. If a wolf attacks or snatches a sheep, false shepherds obviously cares nothing for the sheep. Israel had many false prophets. They had many selfish kings, and they had many imitation messiahs. The flock of God suffered constantly because of this abuse. Because Jesus said, I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, stresses his ownership. He owns the sheep and watch for oversight. He said, my sheep know me, stresses their reciprocal knowledge of and intimacy with him. And the intimacy is modeled on the loving and trusting mutual relationship of the Father and the Son. Jesus came, listen everybody, Jesus came to make us one. Did you hear me? Jesus came to make you and I one. And the other sheep of this flock refers to Gentiles who would believe his coming, Jesus' coming, death, would bring even the Gentiles together to be one flock, one shepherd, that is Jesus. And Jesus is speaking here of the church that will come together as one body of believers in Jesus himself being the head of the church. And last in the 18th verse there, Jesus predicted his death. What did he say? He said, I lay down my life for my sheep. I've got the power to lay it down. I've got the power to take it up again. Jesus was talking about his crucifixion. And so with that, let's hurriedly go into the scriptures and give you just an illustration of what Jesus was actually saying when he said, I lay down my life for my sheep. Got the power to lay it down. And I got the power and authority to take it up again. So we would go to the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus spent his last hour with his disciples. And they would gather there so many times. In the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus fell down to the ground in agony. And Jesus prayed earnestly in the garden. I'm talking about the good shepherd, everybody. He fell to the ground after leaving the supper, walking down through the Kidron Valley into the Garden of Gethsemane with his disciples. Jesus knew what was going on, and he fell to the ground and he prayed earnestly. Judas knew that they gathered there in the garden often. Judas betrayed Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. He betrayed him with a kiss. And he brought with him men and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, coming with lanterns and torches and weapons to do what? To arrest Jesus. Around 300 to 600 soldiers came to the garden. I'm talking about the Good Shepherd. After they arrested Jesus in the garden, they took him to Caiaphas. Caiaphas being the high priest at that time. Listen, Jesus said, I laid down my life. Nobody take it away from me, I lay it down. So he was led to the chief priest, where they just mistreated him. They're in Caiaphas's chambers, they spit on him. Listen to me, they spit on Jesus and they buffeted him. They even took their hand and slapped him with their palms, saying, prophesy unto us, if you be the Christ. They even mocked Jesus, blindfolding him, struck him on the face, saying, who smote you, Jesus? Afterwards, they led Jesus to Pontius Pilate, the governor that being, and man, he interrogated Jesus. And afterwards, they sent him to Herod, because Jesus did no miracle for Herod. He mocked him, putting a gorgeous robe on him. Herod couldn't find any fault with Jesus, so he put a gorgeous robe on him and sent him back to Pilate. He couldn't find any fault with Jesus because Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. He couldn't find any fault. So Pilate said, I can't find any fault in this man. He said, I'll chastise him. That's what I'll do. I'll chastise him and I'll scourge him. Do you know what scourging is? That was the worst treatment that you could give a criminal. They scourged him. They took off his clothes, bent over a stone, and two men called lictors, professionals, they took that whip, cat of nine tails with steel and bone in the tip, and Jesus bent over a stone, and they just stood back and just took that whip, and they beat Jesus. They beat him on his back. And each time they would pull that whip, they would bring flesh from his bones. Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. I lay down my life for my sheep. Yes, Pilate really mistreated Jesus. He couldn't find any fault. As I said, they stripped him and they put on a scarlet robe. And they even planted a crown of thorns, dried thorns, made it in a size of a crown. And they pushed it, they placed it on his brow and just pushed it into his brow. And blood began to flow down his face. And they put a reed in his hands, about 18 inches, mocking him as a king. The king ought to have a scepter. And they put that reed in his hand and they bowed the knee before him. And again, they mocked him. They mocked him by saying, hail the king of the Jews, making fun of Jesus. But Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. He didn't fight back. So after being beaten, maltreated, they compelled Jesus to carry his cross. And after being beaten and shedding the blood and being mistreated, they put the cross beam on his shoulders. Jesus was beaten so badly that as he headed to a hill called Mount Calvary, he was stumbling around like a drunk man. Simon of Cyrene was compelled to carry that cross. Simon picked up that cross, and the hymnologist said, must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No, there's a cross for everyone, and there's a cross for me. Jesus walked onto Mount Calvary. On that hill, they took nails about 8 or 9 inches long, and they nailed them in his wrists to the cross. And they made a platform on that cross where the criminal would stand, and so he could rise himself so he would not suffocate. So they put those nails in his ankles. Jesus suffered immensely on that cross. That's a shame. But Jesus says, I give my life. He gave his life to his captors because he says, I'm the good shepherd. And he went onto the cross. And out there on that cross, it was like hell out there for him. And the story goes on, but go back and read the full story of what Jesus suffered there on that cross. And he went to Pilate, Joseph of Arimathea, craved the body of Jesus, took him down at the cross. Nicodemus helped him carry that body to the cemetery, to the tomb, after they had put spices on him and laid him in that tomb. But you see, Jesus said, destroy this temple in 3 days, I'll rise again. They thought he was talking about the building, but he was talking about his body. And they took him to Joseph's new tomb. No one had ever laid in that tomb. Jesus said, in 3 days, I'll rise again. And guess what, everybody? On Easter, on that third day, Jesus broke the bars of that tomb. The grave couldn't hold him. Jesus got up. Jesus got up. He said, I got the power to lay my life down. I got the power to take it up again. Jesus got up out of that grave. All power, he said, is in my hands. Jesus was no longer in the grave. He got up. The good shepherd who gave his life is alive, everybody. How long? He's alive forevermore. And he's given the power to the church. Jesus got up. Tell somebody this season, Jesus is alive and he's alive forevermore. I'm the good shepherd. My sheep know me. They know my voice. And a stranger they'll not follow. At this season, we call Easter the resurrection. Let's look at it from the standpoint of the love that Jesus gave to all of us. So as we continue celebrating this season, don't forget how much Jesus loved all of us. He gave his life. And as Jesus got out of that grave, as the story goes on, he gave the disciples a command. And the command is to you and I as well. He said, go ye therefore and make disciples of all nations. That's a command, everybody. Go and make disciples. Go make disciples. How teacher? Teaching them, baptizing them, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you, and I'm with you. That's a command that Jesus gave all of us. And everybody, listen. Those of you who are listening this morning and don't know Jesus, this afternoon, you can get to know him right now. How? Just acknowledge that Jesus is the Son of the living God. That he came into the world to die for sinners. That he was crucified. He was buried. He was resurrected. At this second as I talk, he's at the right hand of God the Father, and he's coming back again. He's interceding, but he's coming back again for the church. And you can be a part of that church right now. Just acknowledge who he is, and he will save you right now. So this morning, let's keep in mind, Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. My sheep know me, and a stranger there will not follow. Let's pray. Thank you again, Father, for this time you've given us to share with those who are listening what this season is all about. It's about the death, burial, and resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who got up to give us life. And Lord, may we remember that this season, what it's all about. Thank you, Lord, again, for this opportunity to point someone to Jesus. For us, in his name we pray. Amen.